Hi, everyone. It's Rob Gray from ASU and the Perception Action Podcast again, back with another article review. Today, the topic I want to look at is search. How does a performer search for and find optimal movement solution? And how does this relate to the variability in their search and their movements? So what I'm going to be talking about today specifically is an article by Pacheco and Newell and colleagues that's actually part of a really nice series they've done on looking at the process of search. So in the ecological approach, right, we consider the process of motor learning, we conceptualize it as search through a space, right, a solution space. So a performer is moving through a solution space that's defined by both information and task dynamics, and their movements occur by changing the information sources they use, changing the control laws they use, how they control the movement, and so on. So a performer moves through this space and finds an optimal solution, which we, as a coach, we can help guide by practice design and instruction, which I'll talk about a bit at the end. Right, and this all is part and parcel with the theory of direct learning proposed by Jacobs and Michaels, which I talked about before. And you can find, I have a resource page where I've created infographic and links and things there. If you, there's a link to it there. The particular issue that Pacheco and Newell wanted to look at in this study was the issue of a local minima, right? And this is something I think all coaches can experience, have experienced when working with someone. So what I'm going to use to illustrate this idea is the example they use in the paper, which is a very kind of simple contrived idea, right? It's obviously not meant to represent an actual sporting situation exactly, but just trying to get you the idea across, right? So imagine you are serving against an opponent, right? So you're the server. You want, what you're trying to search for is the place to serve, where you should put your serve, right? And imagine this performer has some, you know, skill, they differ in skill in their return ability to return, right? So if you return serve the ball to their forehand, there's 85% they'll return it successfully. If you serve it right at the body, there's 75%. And if you serve it to the back, their backhand, there's only 60%, right? So in this space defined by, so in the space, we're defining it by the performer's ability to return the serve. 60 is the global minimum, right? That's the best place you could serve. That's the optimal solution. But what you can see is there's a what's called a local minimum, right? That's where a good performance kind of, if you compare it to its nearest neighbor, right? So the idea is if I started with forehand and went, well, that didn't work very well, and I kept changing the direction of my serve slowly, a serve at the body would suddenly be better and I might stop there, right? So a local minimum, the problem here is basically for a coach, right? When a solution is good, but not great, right? It's effective, but not the optimal, right? You're going to have a tendency that observer might get stuck in there, right? So they might find something that worked better than what they're doing before and stop searching, essentially. So that's the problem of a local minimum. And so what Newell and in this paper, Pacheco and Newell doing a look at some factors that influence what could affect you getting stuck in this kind of local minimum in your search process. And a couple of things they're going to look at and I'll talk about is the magnitude of the difference between the local and global minimum, right? So if there's a huge difference between a local and global minimum, you would think you would notice it, right? That, so in my serve, if I serve at the body and then I accidentally do one over to the backhand, I should be a way better performance and I should notice that and I should continue on with my search. That's kind of the idea. Also, what they're going to talk about is the issue of inherent variability. And this is something I've talked about quite a few times, right? The idea that people differ in terms of their just basic ability to produce the same movement, right? So once I've found the movement solution I want, say I've decided I'm going to serve at the body, even though I found the solution, they're still going to vary, right? Sometimes I'm going to be slightly to the forehand, sometimes slightly to the backhand, right? Because of basically natural variation in perception action system. And what we find is there's big differences in individuals in terms of the amount of this inherent variability. There's some factors that seem to predict it, right? Lower, younger, lesser skilled performers are going to tend to have more inherent variability. But basically, they wanted to design an experiment where they could, in a controlled way, look at these different factors and how they influence search. And one of the things that they've wanted to do these experiments for, and why they're taking it into the lab like this, is that search seems to be more complicated than we think, right? So even when in previous studies, even when they create a very simple lab task where there's a very clear optimal solution, right? Which of course is very different than a real sport. But if I create a lab task where there's a very clear optimal solution, we still find that not all performers find this, right? And they search space in very different ways, right? So what Pacheco and Newell and are trying to do here is understand how people search space and why they do and don't find the solution, which is a really interesting and important question. And one of the things they point out is this inherent variability I was talking about, this natural variation you have in a perception action system, could have both positive and negative effects in terms of search, right? So one way it could be positive is if I'm in a local minimum, right? So if I'm in a solution that's good but not the greatest, having some variability could push me out of that, right? You get me out of that attractor well, if you will. So I might by accident stumble on the more effective solution if I have more inherent variability. But it also could have negative effects, because when I do a serve, right, and it doesn't work, or I do a movement and it doesn't work, if I have a lot of inherent variability, it's going to be hard for me to know, was that just due to natural variation, or am I using the wrong solution, right? So inherent variability could potentially mask the solution, right? Mask the error signal that's guiding me, my search, right? So these are the kind of questions they wanted to ask. So what they're going to do in the first experiment, they're going to look at how the structure of the solution space, the task space, influences people's search. In particular, they're going to manipulate those local and global minimum, like in the tennis example, and I'll show you specifically what they did in a second. In the second experiment, they're going to do kind of the same thing, but they're also going to look at how it relates to each individual's inherent variability. Okay, so those are the kind of overview of what they're going to do in this study. So in the study, they used a virtual throwing task. So the task was basically you had to make a movement, a ballistic movement that caused a ball to launch, right? And what you could vary in your movement was basically two parameters, right? The horizontal and vertical velocity, which affects the angle, okay? And so you could control these two parameters to create different throwing motions. And they're going to do 100 trials. And what your task is to try to throw the ball, the virtual ball, to a particular distance, right? And the error score you're going to get, which is going to be displayed on the screen, is basically the distance between where your ball landed and where the target was. So zero is the best possible performance. What's interesting about this is the target was not actually visible to participants, right? They didn't know where they had to throw the ball. What they have to do is search the solution space to find the optimal, right? So basically, they're finding where the target was. All they have is the feedback from their actual movement and the error score they get displayed on the screen, right? And what Pacheco and Newell did in the study, and the authors did in the study, was they created a task space with different local and global minimum, right? To try to see how it affected the search strategy. And basically, there were two kind of properties they varied. They varied the magnitude of difference, I'm going to show the detail in a second, between the global and local minimum. And they also varied the shape of the valley around the local minimum. Okay, so let's look at that in kind of a visual representation. Right. So within the 20, so they had 22 college students, they split them into two groups, right? So the two groups are shown on the top of the bottom. The first group is will be called G75, right? So what this figure is showing is the distance the ball is thrown, right? And what you can see for both groups, the global minimum, the best, where the actual target was, the optimal solution was at 8 centimeters, right? So that's when you threw the ball 8 centimeters, you produced you got a zero score, the best you could get. But you can see as you go across, there's also what are local minimum. Right. So local minimum is just when you look in a small area, the place of best performance. So for the G75 group, the local minimum they got 75 points. Right. OK. So when they hit this local minimum, which was at 4 centimeters. Right. The G15 group, the other group, got a score of 15 when they hit this local minimum. right? So for the top group, there's a much bigger difference, right, between the local and global. And for the second group, G15, there's a much smaller difference, right? The other thing they varied, which you can see in this picture, is by going from left to right, they varied kind of the shape of the local minimum, right? So the shape of the local minimum could be very narrow, more narrow or more wide, right? A wider local minimum, you know, you'd think would be harder to get out of, right? Because you could have some variation within it and still stay in there, right? So these are kind of the representations of the two different, so there's two different groups with two different task spaces. And within each group, there's also a within subject variable of the layout of the valleys and peaks. Okay, so that was the basic design. What they predicted was that participants should find the global solution. They should find the point with zero actual target quicker, fewer number of trials, when there's this bigger difference between the global and local minimum, right? The G75 group, right? Because when you're searching, if I start with 100 points, with this, which is terrible, right? I hit the local minimum of 75, which is a little better. But if I keep moving, I'm suddenly going to go to zero and I'm going to notice, wow, that's a way better solution, right? Versus the second group, the G15, you're going to go from 100 to 15, which is really good. And you might kind of stay there, right? So when there's this bigger difference between a local and global minimum, you might expect people to search more and find the better solution. They should also be more likely to find the better solution when the valley around a tractor in this the task space is more narrow. Okay, so what was actually found? What did they find? First of all, they found, kind of replicating the previous research, that the bottom line here is that search is not just completely dictated by the task space, right? People, if you create very clear optimal solution, people don't just find it, right? So in this case, what they found was there is no actual difference in whether or not people found the solution. So in one group, 6 out of 11 found it, and another group, 4 out of 11. So actually, you know, not that great at finding the actual minimum. And the number of trials it took to find it when they did was not significantly different, 45 versus 30, 53. What was different, and what the task space seemed to influence, was how they searched the space, right? And what they found was that the group G75 group, the group with the bigger difference, explored more and had a better ability to escape from the minimum. So we can look at that. Let's look at that in terms of the actual data. So this data is showing the frequency, the number of trials falling at a certain distance, right? So in a certain area of task space. What I've drawn here is the red arrows are the local minimum, right? And the green is the global minimum. That's the optimal solution. What you can see is what seems to happen with the G15 group is they got stuck in the first local minimum, right? At 4 centimeters. You can see a very large number of the trials is around there. They didn't seem to do it any other trials over here, right? They didn't try larger distances at all. They found this local minimum and got stuck there, which is what they predicted, right? 15 is a really good score in this, right? So you're not really pushed to explore more, right? And it doesn't seem there was an effective condition at all. The G75 group, where there's a bigger difference between the local and global, you can see they explored much more of the task space, right? They had a kind of they were still kind of skewed towards the short throws, right? But they did try some of the longer ones, and they definitely tried some different distances. It doesn't seem like they didn't get stuck in the local minimum nearly as much. But you can see they didn't just find the optimal and stay there, though, right? So the problem was not so much for them. It was not so the problem for the left-hand group is they're not searching enough, right? They're getting stuck. The problem for the right-hand group, the G75, is they're searching, but they seem to be still missing the optimal solution for some reason. Okay, so really, really interesting findings. Again, suggesting it's more complex than just giving people the optimal solution and they'll find it, right? And what seems to be underlying this is individual differences, individual constraints. So in the second experiment, what they did was the same task, same number of trials, 30 new participants. And what they did was instead of what they kind of decided on an intermediate task space. So instead of the 75 and 15, they put a local minimum at 35. So kind of in the middle. And the big new thing they did in the second experiment was they had each participant, they in a separate kind of control measurements, what they did was they showed a visual target for them to aim at. And they had them throw at different target distances, and they measured how consistently they could hit that target. So their inherent variability. And obviously, this differs from person to person. So they wanted to look at how does this inherent variability, which they can quantify, relate to people's search. Okay. And as I said at the start, inherent variability might have both positive and negative effects in terms of your ability to produce outcomes. Okay. And so what did they find? Well, first of all, what they find, again, the story's more complex than we think, right? There's not a simple relationship at all between your amount of inherent variability and whether or not you found the optimal solution and the number of trials it took, right? So people that had were more consistent in hitting the visual target were not more likely to find the optimal solution when it was invisible, right? Or when they did, it was no trial. So these two graphs are really showing no correlation. The circles are when they found the solution, the X's are when they didn't, right? So there doesn't seem to be any relationship between inherent variability in your ability to hit the target and your search. So the next thing they did was kind of ask, well, maybe we're looking at the wrong level of analysis, right? What we're looking at here is variability in outcome, you know, whether you hit the target or not, how away from. What if we actually dig down deeper and look at variability in the actual search, right? The control of what Bernstein calls the elemental variables, right? So in when you have a movement, right, you're searching, there's both outcome variables, your performance outcome, but there's also the elemental variables, the degrees of freedom and movement that you can vary. So what they did was instead of analyzing just the performance outcomes, the distance, what they did was look at the velocities people used, right? What combination of horizontal and vertical velocities did people use? And what they did was kind of go step by step, it's a very detailed analysis, mathematical way they did this. It's kind of systematic. You can read in the paper. I'm just going to give a high level description. What they did was look at the trials people did and the combinations of velocities, and they broke it down into three regions, right? Maintenance is when basically you're not searching at all, right? You're using the same solution over and over, the same combination of horizontal and vertical velocity. A change is when you're trying out different coordination patterns. So you're using different ratios of vertical and horizontal velocity to try to find a new solution. So you're exploring. So that's in terms of Newell's model, that's a change in the coordination solution. The third type of thing they identified, what they'll call covariation, which is basically using the same coordination solution, but changing the control, right? So using the same ratio of vertical to horizontal velocity, basically the same angle you're launching the ball, but changing the actual speeds, the actual component speeds involved, right? So those are the three things. They also noted that when people did this across trials, there were some cases where they jumped to a completely different type of search, right? From changing the coordination solutions to just changing the control parameters and so on. So what they did was they looked at, as I said, in a very systematic way with analysis and the statistical analysis I'm not going to go into, they looked at how these different things, these changes in these elemental variables are related to the people's ability to find the global minimum. And they basically found two overall patterns, right? So people that did this change exploration, so people that tried different coordination patterns, right, and did it kind of continuously, had a higher chance of finding the zero point, the optimal solution, okay? So people that were changing the coordination solution and exploring more were more likely to find the solution, which you would think, which makes sense. Also, people that did those jumps were more likely to find and not get stuck, right? People that change from I'll try a different coordination solution, I'll try the different control parameters, right? People that jumped around and searched in different ways were less likely to get stuck in local minimum and more likely to find the global optimum, right? So the overall conclusions of this study is, you know, and relating it to coaching. So the important point to connection to make here is as a coach in practice design, your influencing the task space, right? You're shaping where you can shape where the local and global optimum are in your practice design by the changing the rules, changing the constraints, right? You can influence these things. The key point though we see from research is this is not just going to dictate the performer finding a solution, right? This task space you define in practice design is going to interact with the individual constraints, inherent variability to produce the outcome, whether or not person finds a solution. So you need to take both of these things into account. The other thing that seems to be the main message is what matters is not your variability in making consistently doing the outcome, right? Outcome variability. What matters in terms of whether people get stuck in a local minimum and whether they find an optimal solution is the variability in their search itself, right? Are you doing that change pattern where you're trying out different coordination solutions? Are you jumping between different ways of searching, right? Maintaining a search so you get information, then next time changing the coordination solution, then next time changing the control parameters, right? And so I think this is a really interesting finding. Again, the story is more complex than just a simple search and finding the global optimum. But as I said, for a coach, I think you can think about this in two ways. Understanding how your practice design is shaping task space and might create a local minimum where people are going to get stuck in a solution that's not where you want them. Also, how can I assess the individual constraints, individual inherent variability of my performer to understand how they're searching and whether they're searching effectively, which is related to what I was talking about a couple of weeks ago in terms of the giving transition feedback as a coach. Okay, that's it for today. Thank you very much for joining me, and cheers for now.